Jason, go ahead.
Yeah, so for you at some point, I imagine you didn't know that you were going to focus in on those two words on authentic business. In the beginning, you were just going, I'm going to experiment and throw spaghetti to the wall and see what sticks. And so I'm more fascinated with that journey of getting to the point, I think most of your audiences as well, is getting to the point of what is my version of authentic business. And that experimentation process, I think, well, yes, I have, let's say I'm more on the 10 categories than the three right now. And now I think as I experiment with those, it's not really a framework yet. At least I don't see it that way. It hasn't, in my mind, come together into a model or a framework or an infographic or a direct, like, this is what I do. I do authentic business. I'm not there yet. And so that's the kind of the journey I think that
Well,
is really interesting.
so you're clear about coming up with content ideas. That's, step one, you're good with that. Step two of categorizing them, you're probably going to be okay with that. Step three of prioritizing the categories, you'll play with that. But here's really where it is. I mean, so you're asking about what happens between step three and four. How do we get to the shortest possible phrasing, right? So here's what I would do, Jason, if I were you. I think this is where, well, I mean, essentially, this is where wordplay comes in.
And also I think that maybe at some point some of those categories might end up in the garbage
Sure, of
and a new
course, of
category
course.
might come along.
Yes, right.
Not
So,
that they're not interesting or fascinating and that I don't
no.
love them, but it
So,
doesn't fit into a,
the categories, whether a category should go in the garbage or not, depends on two things. One is whether you are going to be stubborn about something, even though the audience doesn't want it. So essentially, it's about, well, like I always say, your calling is that intersection between your talents, your passions, your skills, your experiences on the one hand, and your audience's interests, the world's hunger on the other hand. It's that intersection between the two. So essentially, it's like a constant kind of tug of war. It's like who has stronger willpower? Does your audience have stronger willpower pulling you in the direction of, oh, you got to talk about phobias, or do you have the stronger? It's like, no, let's talk about neurosemantics, right? Like, who has the stronger staying power? Really, it's so one example, for I can give you two examples in my business. One is Facebook ads. Like, if money were no issue in my business, and if impact were no issue, like nobody, everyone is full, everyone is happy, everyone in the world is just fine, I wouldn't be teaching Facebook ads. Come on. Who do you think I am? I'm not a sadist, masochist, both, right? I'm not either, right? Like, oh, but the audience's pull is so strong that I have to teach Facebook ads for my audience. They keep asking me of it. And on the other hand, the other example is joyful productivity. Like, nobody, for many years, nobody asked me to teach joyful productivity. Like, nobody would pay for it, at least. Yeah, they have fun sometimes when I talk about it, but nobody would pay for it. It's the worst selling product of mine. But I was so stubborn about it that every year I just kept joyful productivity. Like, every year I just kept bringing it, bringing it, bringing it. And now, literally in the 12th year of my business, no, I think it would start in the 10th year of my business, 10th year of talking till I'm blue in the face about joyful productivity, the 10th year, people started buying it. People started buying it. Like, when I launched it in the 10th year, I'm like, oh my gosh, this is like almost two-thirds as many sales as Facebook ads. Hey, almost, it's like half as many sales, but pretty impressive for a topic that I have forced upon the world for 10 years. Now in the 12th year, as you all know, TLC, my TLC program, is like, oh my God, what happened? It's doing so well. So it took me 10 to 12 years to pull the world along. So that's Jason. So I'm glad I didn't trash it, but I it's almost like you have to be sustained by a popular topic on the one hand that people are willing to buy, while you're like, educating the world for 10 years on this other thing. You see what I mean?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, so I mean, so I think that it is about wordplay also. I mentioned earlier, like, in terms of how do you call the categories, it's wordplay. Like, you just have to go on many dog walks or, you know, river walks or whatever, or, you know, showers and whatever. And then like, wait, I can call it something different, can I? What about this phrasing? Hey, let me try that phrasing for a while. See how the audience responds to it. If the audience loves it, great. Well, that's obvious. The audience doesn't love it, but I'm stubborn about it. Like Joy for Productivity, I'm going to keep telling them for 10 years. I really like the phrasing, right? I'm going to keep going for 10 years. So it's really about who's more stubborn, and you keep playing with the phrasing. You can always change it. After a while, though, once you've published a book on it, you kind of have invested a lot in it. Like Joy for Productivity, like if I were to start over, I'm not sure I'd call it Joy for Productivity. First of all, there's too many letters. It's too damn long, right? I probably wouldn't call it that. I probably call it something else, you know, but I'm stuck with it now because I've published a book on it. I've created several courses on it. People know me for it now. So that's, yeah, I think that, yeah, makes sense.
Yeah, beautiful. Appreciate the sharing.
Yeah, thanks so much.